With a country rebuilding after the recent looting and unrest, Lifeline says it has been receiving a lot of calls with people requesting assistance regarding mental health and emotional wellness. Lifeline South Africa CEO Molefe Takalo joins me now to talk to this matter and more. Molefe, good evening and thank you very much for your time. In terms of the number, quantum, the number of calls that you are receiving daily, particularly in the last week or so.
Good evening, Mr. Mdluli, and to your viewers at home, and thanks for having us. Yeah, look, we have honestly been very much inundated with the number of calls that are coming through. On average, we are receiving anything between 1,200 to about 1,600 calls. But what has happened recently with this current eruptions of the social unrest, majority of the calls that we're receiving, I think over the last 2 weeks or so, were in relation to people who are experiencing, you know, trauma and crisis in their life as a result of the social unrest. You know, emotionally and psychologically, they are being affected quite negatively. And we'll talk later about, you know, one or two examples of cases of people that have been calling and what exactly they've been going through.
Yeah, talk to me then about what you say has been your experience. I mean, did people immediately days or few hours when the unrest started, especially those who have lost their businesses, those who have lost their jobs, and what is the type, the caliber of people who are calling?
No, it varies from individuals. You know, it's people who are calling as individuals who are affected by, you know, some of the happenings and occurrences in their communities, but also there's people who've lost. I mean, I'm sure you'll understand that as individuals, people that have lost their loved ones would normally, you know, give us a call when they're frustrated and they don't know who to talk to, because our services are very much accessible and it's very easy for them to talk to us, and it provides that kind of a privacy. So they will call us from the privacy of their own homes and at their own convenience, you know, when they've lost their loved ones. Particularly this happens immediately after, you know, at the time when people, you know, family members are dying as a result of what has happened. But also, of course, with regard to the ones that are losing businesses, it's actually the aftermath of the social unrest, you know, when, for instance, I just want to say, you know, there are people that are actually been having it tough at the time when we were experiencing the pandemic and the hard lockdown, as well as the regulations and all the restrictions that came with that. And people actually were experiencing challenges in that regard. Now, suddenly, they were trying to rebuild their businesses, and they got hit by the social unrest. So they were actually being dealt a double blow. And it's quite a tragedy because, you know, at one point in one household, you are trying to come to terms with the fact that you've lost a loved one, but at the same time also a family business is struggling. All of a sudden now, at the time when you are trying to get back on your feet, you are now being hit by the social unrest. So it really is a tragedy for the majority of the people that were affected in those communities, in those provinces.
Is there a real threat among South Africans, or a real fear among South Africans of a threat of social instability, to the extent that there are people who are anxious, who are calling you, who believe that actually these kind of events would actually spread and happen again?
Yeah, no, definitely. Look, remember what's currently happening with the pandemic and the hard lockdown and all the atrocities and the devastations that came with that. That in itself as an experience triggers trauma and crisis in people's daily lives. But also what then happens, you know, as a way of reaction, people emotionally and psychologically reacting to any form of social instability. It triggers the new event triggers what you might have actually gone through before. And it's not fear that is baseless. It is based on real experiences and lived experiences. And people are at one point or the other, they will be experiencing, you know, exacerbated type of emotions, if you like, you know, excessive anxiety disorders and all of those. And in many instances, like for instance, when you look at the communication that's circulating on the the social media platforms where that there are threats and some of the baseless and very unfounded information that's circulating. That in itself actually threatens people's lives because it sounds like it's going to be the repeat and people are going to be made to relive the experiences that they thought that they overcame in the past.
Yeah. Now, you think that, of course, a majority of people who are affected by these issues of security and so forth are adults, but you are seeing a fair number of children also being affected, particularly by the loss of freedoms and liberty that are brought on by this situation of unrest, people being hijacked and so on and so forth.
No, absolutely, because I'm sure you'll realize that as a result of this unrest, for instance, in one community, there was one family that actually reported that children are even fearful of even going to school because apparently there were threats that were circulating in the social media platforms where schools were also even threatened, police stations were also even threatened, and the courts and clinics and all of that. So what it does, it actually sparks that level of uncontrollable fear among children in particular. And one family was even saying their children are even afraid. Even long after, the unrest has actually died down, and they were believing that some calm has been restored in those communities, some families were saying to us, some children are even, they're developing these levels of paranoia, they're believing everything that is being communicated in the social media platforms. They even do not want to even, just even go to the shops or even just walk about in townships, in the neighborhood, wherever they live. And now that the schools have reopened, we are yet to hear what is the reaction, particularly from the children. We will give them a day or two after having been to school, and we'll hear what the parents are telling us about that. But so, yes, children are also very much traumatized, and some of them are very affected, particularly in communities where they experience, this social unrest in firsthand, where they were made to witness and observe this happenings and going on in their neighborhoods.
Yeah. And Molefe, how are you alleviating the pressure in society of South Africans at this time?
No, what we are doing, we're using platforms like this one, the media platforms like Newsroom Africa, and we're taking advantage and we are actually making a plea and making a call that communities must not just despair, they must not just lose courage. There's always hope, and there's organizations like us that are there for them. And the fortunate part with our services is that, the access is very easy because they use the toll-free numbers. I'm sure you will show our numbers on your screen later on in order for the viewers to be able to see, our numbers, and they can be able to then call us. We say to them, in Lifeline, as an organization, they have a friend. We are having a set of professionals as well as, lay counselors that can provide that kind of a support, because in times like this, people do need, a shoulder to lean on. And they need the support that they can get. And they don't even have to, with our services, they don't even have to walk to offices. They can just pick up a cell phone and they can call the toll-free numbers. And in that way, our counselors will take them through their experiences. And ultimately, we know they will emerge victorious on the other side. It's not all doom and gloom. It's in the life of a professional in this sector of mental health and emotional wellness, we do go through these kinds of moments, and we do experience this kind of episodes, and this shall come to pass. So we encourage them to call our lines so that they can, be able to relay their experiences and share their trauma with the professionals who will then be able to help them with coping mechanisms insofar as, trauma and crisis containment is concerned.
Yeah. Just elaborate for us a little bit more how important it is. Just that simple act of picking up a line and knowing that there's somebody else on the other side who is just there to listen and give you that kind of counsel. What sort of events were averted just purely by the fact that there was a counselor on the other side of the line?
No, look, in actual fact, in society, issues of mental health, Mr. Mdluli, they are being perceived to be, there's stigma behind that and there's stereotypes. So people are always very fearful to report anything that has got to do with mental health or emotional wellness issues. And it's not very easy in our communities in particular for people to just open up because it's a sign of weakness. I don't know who actually developed that kind of a theory, but we know it as professionals that people are not very comfortable to to share their experiences when it comes to that. So in society, people are being condemned and disapproved, and they're being perceived as being weak. And the significance of them calling us is that, at least in us, our services guarantee confidentiality. So no, I mean, they're not even compelled to give us, to disclose their identity. They can just call us as many times as they want, meaning one caller is not just limited to one call. They can call us 100 times a day for as long as you're not feeling okay with the talk that you would have had with the counselor earlier on in the day. You can do that many times in one day. Our counselors will always be available. But also, one other thing which is very disturbing in communities in particular is the fact that majority of the people do not believe in counseling. And we encourage people to continue to believe in counseling, because you see, with the counselors are trained to deal with issues of mental health and emotional wellness. And these people, it's like in the case of a school where teachers are being trained to educate children. Counselors are equally trained in that field. They are trained to help with the containment of whatever situation that you may be going through. But of course, our organization, our counselors, whenever there's, I'm talking now of, the mental disorder that can be contained. But also, before they can even become worse, because there'll be instances, if people are not going to take advantage of using our services, there'll be instances where their situations can be exacerbated and aggravated to a point where they become long-term mental disorders. And I'm talking of psychosis and schizophrenia and many other illnesses that would require even long-term intervention. It can be rendered in psychiatric institutions, or even getting in some other extreme cases, they can be referred to medical institutions. I've been saying, long before that happens, our counselors are available. And at a very early stage, once a mental disorder is been identified, it's important that they pick up a call and they talk to the counselors, because then you are even averting a situation where your mental condition becomes worse to a point where it requires long type of an intervention which will even require many other aspects of intervention moving forward. So the significance is such that with mental disorders, there's that, because a lot of people may not necessarily be able to know what is going on with them, but once there is that the feeling of uneasiness, when you can't honestly pinpoint what the problem is with you, pick up a phone, use a toll-free number just to phone a counselor, and the counselors will then be able to tell you whether or not you require intervention, and you can do that in the next few days, you can do that in the next few weeks. For as long as you're not feeling okay, pick up a phone and talk to the counselors, because it's very important.
Much appreciated. Thanks for your time tonight. The CEO of Lifeline South Africa, Molefe Dagalo, there with us.